One of the greatest tools in God's tool chest is that of prayer. Jesus handed that tool to us and he says, ask and it shall be given you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. Prayer is that key, that tool that will unlock the unlimited. Let's go to God in prayer. Father, I come to you, my brothers and my sisters, Lord. We come to you, Lord God, and we ask you to pour your Holy Spirit down upon us. We need an anointing, Lord God. We pray for the poor, the fatherless, the widowed, the hurting, the homeless, those that have given up that can't pray for themselves, Lord. We intercede and we ask you to divinely move, Lord God, in our lives, through our lives, that we might help them, give them hope, give them deliverance, Lord. Work in our lives, deliver us from our greed, our selfishness, that we may see and hear the cries of the poor, the fatherless, the widowed, the elderly, Lord, that we might be instruments of your healing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to encourage you to dig down deep and let the power of the Holy Spirit come down upon you as we unlock the unlimited using that wonderful tool that God has given us from his tool chest, the power of prayer. Think about it for a moment. So many things are going on as business as usual because the people that God has called forth at this hour to unlock the unlimited are living in fear and worry and unbelief. It's not enough just to be an advocate for the poor and confront the powers that be. We've got to get down into the very depths of the living God and let his voice speak to us. We've got to be able to hear the cries of those that he hears on a daily basis. We need to know his promises that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. We need to know what Jesus told us, that wherever two or three are gathered together in his name and we pray and call upon heaven and go to the throne of grace, we'll see him do exceedingly beyond what we can even ask or think. The fact of the matter is, so many people today are getting all wrapped up in who will be the president, what can the president do, what can the mayor do, what can the governor do, and we get everything blown way out of proportion. Instead of going and trusting all these political leaders, we're told in the Word of God to go to God. Listen to what he says to us in Psalm 146, verses 3 through 9, where he says, put not your trust in princes, politicians, or anyone else like that, in a son of man in whom there's no salvation. For when his breath departs, he returns to the earth, and on that day, very day, his plans perish. Blessed is he and she whose help is in the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord his God, who made heaven and earth, the sea and all that's in them, who keeps faith forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets the prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the sojourner. He upholds the widow and the fatherless, but the way of the wicked he brings to ruin. Wow. We often get our priorities all messed up, mixed up, and we start looking in the other way, and no wonder we feel like failures and keep beating our head against the wall. We need to unlock the unlimited promised in God's Word. Jesus came. He died. He rose, and he taught us how to pray. His disciples saw Jesus do so many, many miracles, but they didn't say, Lord, show us how to do a miracle. They said, Lord, teach us how to pray. And he gave them the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, not my name. Thy will be done on earth. Yes, thy will be done on earth. Thy kingdom come, not my kingdom come. Get our priorities straightened out. Jesus said, put first the kingdom of God and all these things shall be added unto you. He laid it out before his disciples on how they were supposed to pray, how they were supposed to believe God, how they were supposed to intercede in behalf of those who feel so broken, so crushed, so downtrodden that they can't even pray for themselves. They've just given up. They're like the children of Israel that Moses went to, and he was going to lead them out of Egypt. And God consistently said, let my people go. And Moses goes to Pharaoh and says, let the people of God go. What does Pharaoh do? He takes away the straw with the people making the bricks with and gives them twice as much work to do. And the people were so despondent and so much in despair, well, they weren't able to really cry out to God themselves. Moses had to consistently intercede. And we see that throughout the book of Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Moses interceding behalf of a people that lost their ability to do that for one reason or another. Now you and I need to pray for the downtrodden, the poor, the fatherless, the widow, the hurting. And Jesus lays it out pretty clear to us right here in Luke chapter 11. So I want to encourage you to take a look at Luke chapter 11. And there in verses 5 through 8, he challenges us to engage in persistent prayer. Jesus said, suppose one of you has a friend and he goes to him at midnight and says, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread because a friend of mine on a journey has come to me and I have nothing to set before him. Then the one inside answers, don't bother me. The door is already locked. My children are in bed with me. I can't get up and give you anything. I tell you, though you will not get up and give him the bread because he is his friend, yet because of the man's boldness, he will get up and give him as much as he needs. In this lesson, we see the need for persistent prayer. The trouble is, often you and I don't unlock the unlimited because we don't just keep on knocking, keep on knocking, keep on knocking. He said, knock and shall be opened to you. Seek and you'll find. We need to seek. We need to knock. We need to come before him at this particular time. Yes, here's a man that had a friend, and he continues to let his voice be heard. Now, Jesus also in this context, as he was teaching on prayer, told his disciples, he said, you know, if a child asks his father for a fish, will he give him a serpent or a stone? Will he give him, a bread? Will he give him a stone? How much more so will your Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? So as we unlock the unlimited, we go before God, we keep on knocking, we bring this need to him, and we also ask him to give us the Holy Spirit so we can continue to persevere, keep on moving, keep on knocking, keep on seeking. And so we see in this story here how important that he kept on doing it. So we're told here in Hebrews also in chapter 4, verse 16, I'd like to interject here, that let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence so we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. And the basis for this is that because we have a great high priest who's gone before us. And so we go to the throne, and not to the phone, complaining about this person, that person, this, that. We go to the throne of grace. So as we move back here to Luke 14 and verse 6, we see a caring man interceding in behalf of his friend, in behalf of a person who needs food. He says, a friend of mine on a journey has come to me. And so far in this teaching and prayer, we have seen that here's somebody who really cares about somebody else. And that's so key. Lord, help me to care. It's so easy for our hearts to get hard today. Jesus said, in the last days, the love of many will grow cold. We're bombarded day after day from the media about this tragedy happens, that tragedy happens. We live in an angry world, and it's so easy for us just to withdraw and just kind of parade around with the name tag of Christian. But, you know, what happens is these people who do that, they're so quick to just give up when they don't see immediate response. They don't continue to unlock the unlimited. They're not engaging in bold prayer. They're not continuing to keep on knocking, knocking, knocking. And so why does God want us to do this? He wants us to show that we really care about this person, that we really care about their need, and we're willing to engage in persistent prayer. Maybe the Lord has laid upon your heart someone who's sick, someone who's hurting, someone who just never seems to really get it together. It may be a husband, it may be a wife, it may be a child, it may be a friend. So you take them to the Lord and you lay it down and say, Lord, they need the bread of life. Lord, they need a miracle right now. I'm going to continue to keep on knocking. I'm going to continue to keep on asking. You told me to do that. Why do we pray? We don't pray to play God. We don't pray to be God. We pray to obey God. And when he says, ask and it shall be given you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. We're going to be obedient. We're going to pray. We're going to believe God right now. We're going to draw close to the Father. And based on the new covenant, that if anyone be in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has passed away. The new has come. We're going to believe God and take him at his word. And so we take a look here at God's word and we see, what is he trying to tell us at this time? He's trying to tell us to just continue to believe, continue to trust him, not to give up, but give it to him. We're serving a mighty God. And so as we continue to keep on knocking, he's going to answer, and we're going to see him do exceedingly abundantly beyond what we can even ask or think. Psalm 34, it's a righteous cry out and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. A righteous man may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers him from them all. He protects all his bones, and not one of them will be broken. Over and over, as I've worked with the poor and the homeless the past 48 years, I've seen that being true. So many troubles, so many problems, so many trials and tribulations, and yet I see that God answers prayer. Why, just today, facing tremendous financial needs, I was on my knees crying out to God. I was laying in my bed crying out to God. And what happens? I get a report from the office that $500 was dropped off at the front door. I don't know who did it, but I thank God for it. $500 dropped off at the front door in St. Louis. Day before, $1,200 from somebody in Springfield. And you say, well, that's a lot of money, but it takes like $10,000 a day for all these different facets of the work of New Life Evangelistic Center around the world to be met. God is a miracle working God, and we're still here. Tremendous needs we have. I won't go into detail with you about all of them. So many people are hurting. So many people are homeless. So many people need to come to our safe houses. So many need to get into the training programs. Just continue to preach the gospel around the world through social media and NLEC TV and all the other needs that just keep compounding day after day. But God is right there in the middle of those needs, and He'll be right there in the middle of your need. And that's why it's important that we come to Him right now and tap into the power of prayer. Go before the throne of grace. Allow Him to do exceedingly abundantly beyond we can even ask or think. Oh, I see how God is just moving right now in just such a special way. Yes, Luke chapter 11, verse 5 to 8. I'll read it again. Which of you who has a friend will go to him at midnight and say to him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. For a friend of mine has arrived on a journey and I have nothing to set before him, and he will answer him from within. Do not bother me. The door is now shut and my children are with me in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything. I tell you, though he will not get up and give him anything because he's a friend, yet because of his impotence, you will rise and give him whatever he needs. And I tell you, ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be open. Verse 9, Luke chapter 11. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks it will be opened. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. Oh, let's just go to Him in prayer. Let's just open up our hearts and minds right now and let the Holy Spirit come and fill us. Let's believe God for that miracle that you need at this particular hour. Let's agree together in prayer and unlock the unlimited. Are you believing God at this moment? Are you praying? Are you going through the throne and just laying all those needs down before Him? As Paul tells us in Philippians chapter 4, verse 13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Oh, understanding the power of God is understanding the compassion of God, knowing that He wants to do exceedingly abundantly beyond we can even ask or think. Knowing that He hears the cries of the poor, the fatherless, the widowed, the hurting, the homeless, the elderly, and He's calling forth His people at this hour like never before. Will you intercede? Will you be the one that will stand in the gap at this particular moment? In John chapter 5, we see a man at the pool of Bethesda. He was there beside that pool of Bethesda for 38 years. The angel would stir the water, but somebody else would always get in. And Jesus comes to this man and He asks him, He says, do you want to be healed? And the man says, yes. And so Jesus heals him. Now, the powers that be saw Jesus as a nuisance. And they consistently attacked Him whenever He would heal somebody on the Sabbath as He unlocked the power of God. They were so caught up in their rituals, so caught up in their traditions, they could not rejoice over the one that was set free. And Jesus would consistently come back to them and explain to them why it was so important to unlock the unlimited. That the Sabbath was created for man to give him a chance to rest, not man for the Sabbath. And if your donkey or your ox fell into a ditch, wouldn't you take him out? If he was all bound up, wouldn't you set him free? How much more so those that are bound up and with paralysis and sickness and demonic possessions? Each time Jesus healed on Sabbath, they'd criticize him for it. But Jesus would see it as another person set free as He unlocked the unlimited. And He tells you and I in John chapter 14, verse 12, 13, 14, behold, I tell you the truth. If you believe in me, you can do the very works I do. Yes, even greater things, because I'm going to the Father. Whatever you ask the Father in my name, I will do it. Wow. And here we sit back totally defeated when He's given us this wonderful tool from His tool chest that, even greater things, if we dare to believe, because He's gone to the Father. And you and I can unlock the unlimited, and here we sit, we whine, we cry, we run to the phone and complain about this and that, rather than running through the throne of grace and letting Him pour His Spirit down upon us. Oh, the Lord is so good. Time is so short. How much time have we wasted in life because we've just continued to worry, worry, worry? There was a cemetery in Indiana, and on an old tombstone it said, Paul, stranger, when you pass me by, as you are now, so once was I, as I am now, so you will be, so prepare for death and follow me.
And somebody went and wrote underneath that tombstone, "To follow you, I'm not content until I know which way you went." There it is. Which way are you going? Oh, Jesus can assure you in your heart that you're coming, that he's going to take, he's gone to prepare a place for you. He says, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." We get so stressed out. I do, you do, we all do. And we got to come to him because all this stuff doesn't really matter. He tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 that those that remain steadfast to the end, the same shall be saved. He wants to give us victory if we'll but listen to him and we'll come to him. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 20, we're told, "But our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control will transform our lowly bodies so that we will be like his glorious body." Yes, it takes faith to unlock the unlimited. It takes faith to unlock the unlimited. How do you spell out the word faith? F can be for forsaking, A for all, the I, well, is I, the T is take, and the H is him. Forsaking all, I take him. That's faith. "Lord, I'm just laying it down. I have nowhere to go but to you. I don't know which way I'm going to go, Lord, except to you. There's no other place that I can go." Jehoshaphat did that when he was facing overwhelming odds. As they began to praise God and worship God and moved into battle, forsaking all, I take him, they saw a great victory. Now, you've tried this, you've tried that. Maybe it's for your own healing. Like the woman that touched the very hem of Jesus' garment for all these years. She went from doctor to doctor, touched the hem of Jesus' garment, unlocked the unlimited, and experienced a healing. I want to encourage you to touch the hem of Jesus' garment right now at this time. Spell out the word faith in your life. Forsaking all, I take him. Are you struggling with sin? You don't know what to do about it? And spell it backwards, N-I-S, now I surrender. Forsaking all, I take him. Jesus said that a mustard seed of faith can move a mountain. He's inviting you and me at this moment to unlock the unlimited, to come. He says, "Come to me, all you who labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Listen to this promise right now that's awaiting you and I in 1 Corinthians 15, 57 and 58, where we're told, "Thanks be to God. He gives us a victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain." Stand firm. Don't give up. Your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Now, if you pick up your Bible and you open it to Revelation chapter 12, you'll see that when Satan is thrown out of heaven, he goes on this crazy rampage. And how can the people of God be victorious in the middle of that? How did they overcome him? They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives unto death. They completely confronted Satan to the point that even if they were killed in the battle, that wasn't the end of the story. They were coming into the very presence of God. There's no way the devil can beat down a believer. Because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we are more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. And we can unlock the unlimited, and we can begin to move forth in the midst of that unlimited. Politicians can't stop us. The powers that be can't stop us. We've experienced a greater and more powerful force, and that's the living God. And as many as call upon the name of the Lord, they shall be saved. And we can begin to walk in victory, experiencing the limited, both now and for all eternity. To get a great perspective on this and faith at work, go to that great faith chapter of Hebrews chapter 11, and you'll see that some immediately got their victory, some immediately won, some, though, didn't get it until after they had died and gone into the very presence of God. So don't give up if you don't see everything working out just the way that you expected at this moment. Know that he's going to do exceedingly abundantly beyond we can even ask or think. I look back through my life, and some of the greatest prayers I had answered were the ones when he gave me a loud, clear no. I didn't understand at the time. I was tempted to get disillusioned at the time. But those that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. I had to remain steadfast, immovable, abounding in the work of the Lord. I want to encourage you to do that at this particular time. Some within the sound of my voice are wavering between two opinions. Some are about to give up. Some are doubting and are unstable. You know, just going back and forth, as James chapter 1 says. It's critical that we come to him. We let His Word get down deep within our spirit that we can stand steadfast, immovable, abounding in the work of God. There's certain things in my life that I haven't seen change. There's certain things in my life where I feel like I'm bucking my head against the wall. Certain things in my life, I'm tempted to just give up. But He tells me to remain steadfast, and He's telling you to remain steadfast. And as we remain steadfast, His Word is working within us, and He's unlocking the unlimited. We may not be able to see it right at this moment, but He's doing far beyond we can even ask or think. Think of Jacob. Jacob was at the point of total despair. His sons had gone to Egypt. His youngest son had to go now. And they know what's going to happen to him. And Jacob says, if he dies, I've already lost Joseph. I can't lose anymore. Little did he know that God was unlocking the unlimited. And the one who's making all these requirements was Joseph, his son there. And when he got there, he saw how God had unlocked the unlimited. Now, I want to encourage you right now at this particular moment to unlock the unlimited. Get into His Word. See what He's trying to tell you at this moment. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8 tells us this. While we were spiritually dead in sin, God made us alive with Christ. Yes, you have been saved by God's gracious love, and God raised us up from spiritual death and seated us in the heavenly world with Christ Jesus. God wanted to show the superior riches of His gracious love for all time. He did this by using Jesus to be kind to us. You have been saved by God's gracious love through faith. Forsaking all, I take Him. There it is. Look what He's done for us. We are more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. So it's time that we stop seeing ourselves as victims and start seeing ourselves as victors. It's time we stop whining and start winning and dare to believe and unlock the unlimited. Jesus tells us this. Jesus sees the end result of those who unlock the unlimited. When the power of God came upon Paul, he began to see it also, as well as countless Christians throughout history. Now it's your opportunity. Now it's my opportunity. There we are. There's this great host of witnesses that are watching us, as we're told in Hebrews chapter 12. They're beholding right now as we're out here on the stage of life. So let's remain steadfast. Let's unlock the unlimited. Let's dare to believe, forsaking all, I take Him. And that includes forsaking sin. Now I surrender. I come to You, Lord Jesus. I know that the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses me from all sin, and it cleanses you. Unlock the unlimited. We want to get into this Word of God at this moment. At this moment, you may feel totally harassed. You may feel like broken down, crushed from every side. Don't give up. Give it to God. And I just feel a burden on my heart right now to pray for some of you that are right on the edge, that say that I can't take it no more. Get into God's Word and see that He will not allow you to be tempted more than you can bear. With every temptation, there's a means out. But we find it only through Christ and not through Satan putting a boat there like it did for Jonah, where we end up in the bottom of some whale's belly because we're not going the direction God wants us to go. Let's unlock the unlimited. Let's go with God. Let's get into the Word of God. Let's get into the Word of God and stop letting the ego prevail in our lives. What's the ego stand for? Edging God out. Well, let's come to Him right now. As many as call upon the name of the Lord, they shall be called the children of God. Remember John chapter, what He told us. He says, behold, I tell you the truth. If you believe in Me, you can do the very works I do. Yes, John chapter 14. Yes, even greater things from going to the Father. Whatever you ask the Father in My name, I will do it. Father God, I'm coming to You right now with my brothers and my sisters. And we're asking in Your name, Lord Jesus, for that healing. We're receiving that healing. In Your name, Lord Jesus, we're asking for that financial provision to meet that overwhelming financial need that tends to wear us down. We receive the victory right now. Father, in Your name, we pray for that wife. We pray for that husband. We pray for that child. And in Jesus' name, we receive this miracle at this moment as we unlock the unlimited, standing on the promises of Your Word, knowing that we're more than conquerors through You, Christ Jesus, who strengthens us. In Your name we pray, Lord Jesus. We receive the miracle at this moment as we release our faith, unlock the unlimited, and move into spiritual realms like we never have before. In the name of Jesus, we receive this. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask Him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.